Okay, I'll start with a quick introduction. I'm Sunit. I work as an application developer in ThoughtWorks. And with me...
I'm Girish. I'm also an application developer in ThoughtWorks.
Okay, so this kind of a little bit advanced topic on the container world, most of you, I think, must be having some sort of experiences working with the containers and all that. What we are talking today is, I'll just give you the quick overview first. We are trying something different. We'll start from spinning up the cluster. So it's like zero, and how we can get up and running in within the session itself, which gives you the feel of how easy or difficult it is to get all of this working in your environment, right? So we'll start with spinning up the cluster on Google Cloud. We'll, by the time the cluster comes up and all that, we'll go through why we need service mesh. What is service mesh? Setup. Then we'll do the second step. Since the cluster is fresh new, we have to set up Istio and everything inside it. So we'll set up Istio and service mesh inside the Kubernetes cluster. And then we'll go through the Istio architecture. We'll look at the different demos of all the possibilities or the solutions that we can put in the service mesh, right? And then the demos at the end, right? Now, so to start with, yeah, so we have a too many demos, so please bear with us if we go wrong somewhere. So
next. Yeah, fingers crossed. And just,
yep.
Cool. So we'll be setting up a Kubernetes cluster. To set up Kubernetes cluster, we went a bit little bit jazzy. We didn't want to use a normal CLI, so we created a chatbot. So that with the help of which we will spin up a cluster now. So I'll invoke this chatbot. Okay, Google, can you talk to Peter Griffin?
Okay, let's get the test version of Peter Griffin. Hello, master. What can I do for you today?
Can you create a Kubernetes cluster for me?
Okay, master. How many machines would you like to have in your cluster?
I would like to have 3 machines in the cluster.
I have created a cluster demo cluster with 3 nodes.
Thank you.
Oh, is it? But you are the one who created me, master. Have a nice workshop. Bye-bye.
Cool. So let's refresh the GCP page and let's see if Peter is telling the truth. Yeah, so we have a demo cluster being in a creation stage. So it has 3 nodes. So let's go back to the slides till then, till it is up.
So I think we got the cluster setup part done, which is as easy as like you have a visual interface as well as command line also. Is just automated with the chatbot then, right? Now, once we have a Kubernetes cluster, I think how many of you are using microservice architecture or have worked on the microservice? Fair. I think now the next slides of things that I'm going to talk about will, I think you'll be able to resonate well, right? How many challenges we face? I think when we start the journey for implementation of microservice architecture, I think there are many, many different things that we have to go through. So there are many cross-cutting concerns that we have to implement, right? Starting from the simplest one is the service discovery, right? People can imagine, right, how easy or complex it can be, right? There are many ways, and the most complex part is getting the client-side discovery done. Otherwise, every time when you have to make one service call to another service, you go via some gateway which is increasing the hop and increasing the latency, right? So if you have to take care of that, right? Otherwise your simple call on monolith will take milliseconds, here it will go into seconds, right? It's just that because we are calling too many services internally, correct? Now this is like getting it right is very important, right? Traffic management, throttling, right? This is also one of the key requirements that we have, which is like, okay, one service is bombarding the other service and bringing down services for everybody else, right? So you have to make sure that you have certain throttling implemented, right? If one service goes bad, it's okay, that is the only one culprit that will get affected. Then resiliency, circuit breakers, health checks, fault injection, all that is like, yes, we have to do that, right? Going ahead with more security, very important, right? Zero trust. I don't want one service to trust other service by default. There should be some authentication mechanism, right? Authorization, all that has to be in place. They should be talking over SSL, right? Secure connections. I don't want to keep it open on HTTP, correct? All that needs to be taken care of. Monitoring, again, how much response time that each service is producing, which can give me an ability to know that if I have a problem in my user experience, I can go and find out where actual bottleneck is, correct? And testability, if I want to deploy another version of a service, then it's important that I am able to test it before I roll it out to everyone, right? So A/B testing, candidate testing, all that has to be done. And when I think of all this, and whenever I try to think that, okay, I want to go with the microservice, that all these concerns take a shit out of me. I always feel like, I really want to do microservice, or should I stick to my old ways of getting stuff done? Right? These are the challenges. How many of you resonate with this kind of challenges that you are facing? Right? It is important to get this right. Now, this is a scary thing, right? Because once you have too many services, you have large number of inter-service connections, right? The first time when I was doing this, after some time, I didn't have any clue which service is talking to which service. And then started creating diagrams. Okay, let's have some repository somewhere to make sure that we know who is talking to which service. Again, zero trust, authentication, all that is to be in place, right? Multiple point of failure. Again, in standard applications, I can just fail my application and I know it failed. Now here I have to monitor like hundreds of microservices. One can go down and that can have a bad experience on the user, right? So this is all very critical in terms of implementing the microservices, right? But we have tools, right, which are given by obviously Netflix most of the time. We have many tools. We have a tool to take care of a problem. Fair? How many of you have used most of these tools? Yes, right? Fair. Now, have you noticed this kind of, I'm taking one of the example from the problems. Have you noticed this kind of a problem there? Right? Timeouts. One service to another, another service to another, another service like that. It just goes on, right? Where do we keep all this configuration? We have to configure it, right? Where? Web.config, which is inside your application, right? Now, each application knows about this. One person changes it in one application, it can have a ripple effect over all the services, right? I'm just creating the problem statement right now in the first part, right? Now, this is where my all configs are, which is in the application. And this is where the challenge is. Now, for each problem, I have a tool that I have to use, right? Now, for 10 types of different problems, I'll be using 10 different tools. Every time I have to go and research which tool is right. Is there any newer, better tool available, right? So, Uber is also publishing nowadays all the tools, right? As like Netflix. Which one I choose? I have to make a choice. Then I have to implement it in each of the application. I have to go and make sure that each of the 30 services are using those tools, right? And the right versions. That is also important, right? If they are not backward compatible, it's going to bomb, right? I think it will not have the overall objective achieved. Again, challenge is that upgrading these tools or changing this tool to a newer, better tool. Now 30 services, one service nobody is touching from last 6 months because they're stable and running, that itself becomes a project. Oh, we have to change this Netflix Zipkin to Uber Yagato. Now, let's take it as a project. Now, that kind of problem we start facing once we are into this world. The solution is service mesh, where it can help to connect, secure, and observe our services. So now, on the application code side, we have our microservice. This is a standard where we have our business logic, and along with the business logic, we have our all the cross-cutting requirements, right? As we talked about, all the configs are stored within the microservice, right? All my configs of the timeouts and the libraries, they all reside in the same application code base. So in a way, I am polluting my code base with all this knowledge, right? What could be better is if we have a pod, which is again a Kubernetes world definition, a microservice and a proxy. Now proxy replaces all this cross-cutting concerns that I have to implement for the application. So let's say I have a two pod running, and each pod is having a microservice and a sidecar proxy. Now to talk outside, it has to go through proxy, and even the incoming traffic that comes in is via proxy. So all incoming and outgoing traffic are via the sidecar proxy. Now that proxy is going to do the magic for us, and that's what the in nutshell is service mesh all about. Fair? So it's like how many of you have used AOP in the Java world, right? It's like AOP of the Java world, right? On top of my service I have a proxy, or alongside my service I have a proxy which is taking care of all these communication challenges, right? So with this proxy, what I can do? I can do traffic control, bring resiliency, retries, monitoring, observability, telemetry information, and also bring in security. Service to service communication, site proxy to proxy, can be a secure connection because that's the outside of my pod, right? My actual service is talking to my proxy internally. Fair? Is this clear? Yeah, this is the main concept of the whole service mesh all about. Now on technology radar, this has been on to assess from November 2018. So we'll jump into the Istio bit now.
So Istio is an open source implementation of service mesh. It is created by Google, Lyft and IBM. So it allows you to connect, secure your microservices. You can do a lot of things like load balancing, observability, telemetry, authentication, authorization without changing any single piece of code. So that's where it is so much powerful. So before we deep dive into Istio, let's set up Istio first in our newly created cluster. So to do that, we have Istio is available as a Helm chart. Helm is a package manager for Kubernetes. So it's just as simple as doing Helm install Istio. So there are a couple of steps which I need to do. First, I need to set up my Kubernetes CLI so that I can connect to my newly created cluster. So for that, I have already created a script which I can just invoke now. So it will get my Google account and get the configuration and put it in my kubeconfig. And my kubectl should be connected to the newly created cluster in GCP. So if I now do kubectl get nodes, I should be able to see three nodes. Yeah. So to set up Istio, So first we need to initialize the Helm in the cluster, and then we can just say Helm install Istio. So let's do this. Set up Istio. So this is gonna take some time. Till then we can go back to the slides and talk a bit more about Istio's architecture. So Istio's architecture is very, very, very similar to how Kubernetes is designed. So there is a data plane and a control plane. The data plane basically consists of envoy proxies. So envoy proxies, as Sunit mentioned, they live as a sidecar next to your container. So inside a Kubernetes pod, you will have an envoy proxy and your application sitting here. All the communication between to service will happen via this proxy only. So this envoy proxy was written by Lyft, a US based company. It's a very lightweight proxy written in C++, just 8 MB in size. The control plane basically consists of three components. The first component is pilot. The role of the pilot is to dynamically configure your envoys with the rules that you provide. So if I want to do any traffic based routing, which we will see, we'll send those requests to pilot. Pilot will at the runtime configure those envoy proxies. No restarts required. The next component is Citadel. Citadel manages all the certificates like TLS certificates in the cluster. It will keep on periodically also rotating the certificates as well. The third and the important component is Mixer. Mixer talks to Envoy and collects all the telemetry data that is flowing inside the cluster. It will also make sure that the policy checks are enforced in the cluster as well. So we have a, and yeah, the communication between envoy to another envoy can be with or without TLS. So for demo purposes, we have a book info application, and Sunit will talk about it.
So this is a book info application provided by the Istio people only for demoing their capability and everything, right? Now in this book info application, it is a simple microservice architecture. Again, there are multiple services and the one UI service or application running. So this is the main product page from where it makes different calls. So one call goes to the product detail service, the another call goes to the review, I'll come to that, and review makes a call to rating. Now on review side, we have three versions deployed, V1, V2 and V3. V1 is simple without rating. V2 is rating in black color with stars, and V3 is rating in red color, right? Now these are the three versions available, and V2 and V3 talks to rating to get the actual rating data, right? So this is how the setup is done. Now with the Istio, we will have the whole setup where we have every pod running a service alongside a sidecar proxy, right? So each of these is having that, and a ingress controller to start incoming requests.
Yeah. So to install this book info application, we already have the YAML files that that are Kubernetes YAML files ready with us. So basically, these are the four YAML files: details, product page, ratings, and reviews. What they will basically do is create a deployment object and create a service object correspondingly. So let's install book info application. Istio is set up. So I'm gonna just say kubectl apply minus f the whole book info folder. So it will create service objects for four microservices and deployment objects as well. So now if I say kubectl get pods, I see there is details, product page, ratings, and there are three pods for reviews running because we have three versions. And if you can see here, Istio has injected a sidecar container automatically. So there are two containers that would be running for each pod. So if I refresh, do kubectl get pods again. So I see each application now has two containers up and running, okay? So what Istio requires is that all the communication should, all the requests should be incoming through its ingress gateway. We just need to configure the gateway. People who have worked with HA proxies, Nginx will relate to this. So this is how you configure a gateway. You basically say this gateway will listen on these three hosts on port 80. That's we put in server blocks in an Nginx config file. And then we do some path-based routing. We basically say any request coming from bookinfo.com, if it has these URLs, then read and then direct that request to a product page host on port 9080. Now this product page host is nothing but a Kubernetes service. So we already created a Kubernetes service with the name product page. This product page is registered as a DNS in the Kubernetes cluster. So we're basically saying if the request is coming as bookinfo.com/productpage, go to product page service. So let's install this gateway.
All this code will be sharing on the GitHub so that you can look into it later on as well.
So now if I go to my browser and go to bookinfo.demo.com/productpage, we have our application up and running. So if I now refresh, you will notice the ratings are changing.
Notice this part changing, right? So no rating, red color, black color. So these are the three services. It's going in round robin default way to each of the service as a simple configuration setup.
So by default, Istio is load balancing in a round robin fashion to V1, V2, V3. Now let's imagine a scenario that we want to control this traffic. Let's imagine a use case where we have rating service under development. It is not ready for production use case. We want to control, we don't want any request going to rating service. So basically what I need is I want every user coming to my application should only see reviews version V1. No request should go to reviews V2 or V3. Okay. So how I can do that is, so basically what I will say is I will divide my traffic into three subsets. I will say traffic coming for reviews consists of three subsets, V1, V2 and V3. V1 subset consists of the pods which have a label version V1. V2 subset consists of the pods which have label version V2. And similarly, V3 subset consists of the pods which have version as V3. Now, what I need to do is I want to say whenever there is a request coming for reviews, route it to reviews, but only to subset V1. So I will not change any of the application code. I will not uninstall reviews V2, V3. Reviews V2, V3 will be running there. I will just apply this traffic route so that all the traffic now goes to reviews V1 only. Okay, let's see this. So now if I refresh the page, I do not see any rating. And in n number of times I refresh, every time the request is going to V1. So that's where Istio comes into picture. You can control the traffic, any traffic routing you can do. Now let's imagine a second scenario. We have this ratings now developed, but we do not want to roll it out to everyone. We want to do a canary release. We have a special user called Peter. I'm already signed in as Peter, I'll sign out. So I have a special user Peter. So when Peter signs in, he should only see the ratings. Nobody else should see the ratings. Okay, just a canary release. So how we can achieve this with Istio is, so we can do a header based content routing. We can basically say if the request is coming for reviews and the header contains Peter, then route it to V2 subset, otherwise route it to V1 subset. I do not change any application code, in just configure my envoy to direct the traffic to V2 when the header contains Peter. Similarly, you can imagine use cases using user agents. You can say if the request is coming from an iPhone or from an Android or from a Google Chrome, from a Mozilla Firefox, you can direct traffic correspondingly. So let's apply this. So as a normal user, I still do not see ratings. Now when I sign in as Peter, I see ratings in black color. I refresh the page, I see the ratings in black color. So I have basically canary released this feature to Peter. So similarly, we can also do weight based routings. So we can say if I want to now roll out ratings to everyone, but I want to say 80% of the request still should go to V1, but 20% of the request should go to V2, so that I tested how my rating service is behaving. So I can say route 80% of the request to V1, weight 20 to V2. So in this way, you can configure these traffic routes. So let's say our rating service is developed. It is ready for production. We want to roll out to everyone. So I will say I want to route it to everyone. So I just need to configure my route accordingly. So I say whenever the request is coming to reviews, just route it to V2 with no clause of headers and anything. So I will just apply it. So now if as a normal user, I refresh the page, normal user sees ratings. Okay. Now let's imagine a use case where I want to test fault tolerance of my application. I want to test how resilient my microservices are. If one of the microservices down, how my UI behaves, right? So for that as well, what Istio provides us some traffic routes rules. So you can say, if the request is coming for ratings and Peter is the user, then abort that request with 500 status. But for every other user, just proceed normally. So you can do this kind of testing in production as well with production test users. So you can do some rejects matching here. You can inject delays as well here to test how the timeouts and your delays are working. So here we are just aborting the request for ratings for Peter with a 500 error. So let's apply this.
I think this fault injection is very powerful, and I think it's very helpful for doing all the testing, specifically in case of worst case scenarios.
So right now for the normal user, everything is working fine. Now let's say Peter signs in. This is rating service is currently unavailable. So basically the UI has handled this scenario gracefully. So I can see, okay, my application is working correctly. If there is any fault to rating service, I am displaying exact error accordingly.
So you can handle gracefully whatever you want. You can test it now. Otherwise, bringing down a service and testing is a very difficult task in production, right? Yes. There is a round robin happening, right? You need to have more pods for a V1 node. Then it'll, and you can have automated scale up and scale down for each pod cluster. It's like pod, deployment.
Pods will be required.
Yeah, pods. You have to use the deployment for that purpose.
So one question. So you showed all of this use case already. Istio is not there. How would we do the Kubernetes itself, like pushing the
gamut? It's not possible, to be honest, right, specifically. And there are workarounds that you have to do, which will not give you this kind of flexibility without downtime and all that. And you have to do a lot of workarounds, like you canary release also is possible, but it's difficult. I think we'll continue, we'll take the question answer at the end. We have lot of things still to cover and to show you. There are really good stuff there. So we looked at the demos, like we looked at the service discovery that is happening. We looked at the A/B testing, canary release and all that stuff. We looked at the fault injection as well. These are just tip of the iceberg. You can use many, many more use cases that you can come. The most important part that Girish mentioned is the header based routings, right? And header based fault injection. If you put your architecture in place where you have good amount of information which you want to control in Istio, in the HTTP headers, your job is done. Fair? So yeah, let's look at how it internally works a little bit, very high level from the 100 feet, not going to the actual low level. So I say that there is a Istio and Kubernetes as one part and then services. So as soon as your services are up, I think the services register themselves to the Kubernetes masters and it is available, right, as a endpoints in the service, right? Similar way, Istio is also there, and all this information is fed back to the envoy proxy, which is similar to the kube proxy which is running on your actual nodes, right? Now envoy proxy has all the knowledge about all the services and endpoints and all, so that it can achieve the client side routing. Fair? Now if you have so now if you have a traffic rules that you have applied, like Girish was doing that fault injection and everything, as soon as the traffic rules are applied, they are pushed to the and why proxy again. So that's how the control plane is coming to the picture of the Istio and pushing all the details to proxy. Now when actual request, if service A wants to talk to service B, it makes all outgoing traffic through Envoy. In some cases, Envoy needs to talk to Istio for getting the telemetry data constantly if you have the percentage based routing, because it could have happened that another pod somewhere else is also making these calls and all this telemetry data has to be centralized somewhere, right? That's where the mixer comes into the picture, and again percentage based routing also can be achieved. Now if you do the user based routing or the header based routing specifically, now this is very classical problem. Lot of time we want to have a different services to be in place for Android and to be in place for iPhone, right? Now this is very classical use case that I've used in multiple projects, where you can just have the user agent on the header and then have the traffic going into the different actual implementations. Now without anywhere in the code getting polluted, all this can be achieved. Next. Now let's look at, so this is the use case of the how you can do all the configurations in the Istio. Let's look at some telemetry information.
Yeah. So as we said, mixer is collecting all the telemetry data. Any request flowing to Envoy is registered as a metric in mixer. So when you set up Istio, Istio by default installs Prometheus, Grafana and Jaeger for you. So let's see what metrics we have already in the cluster.
Here you will have just the data of last 10 minutes because our cluster is fresh new, just created just now, right?
Or something happened with the, so we have a backup cluster running, so I'll just show the metrics there. So these dashboards in Grafana just come out of the box. We haven't installed anything ourselves. So if I just see the data for last 3 hours, if I made, yeah, I made some requests. Yeah, monitoring is down. Okay, I got it. I need to apply a rule.
So now the all telemetry data is also collected and then configured to send to the Prometheus Grafana setup for the monitoring purpose and Jaeger for the distributed tracing. So those who have used Zipkin will be able to relate to the distributed tracing easily, right? Now this is as good as, this is like beauty of combination of Docker containers, Kubernetes, and on top of that it's the service mesh, right? All these are working together to make and give you this kind of a output.
Yeah, so these all dashboards come out of the box when you install Istio. So you can see a request flowing in out, what is the response time, per response code you can also see. The most important tool is Jaeger. So with Jaeger, it lets you do distributing tracing of the requests. So let's say I select product page and I do find traces. So I can see how each request went to which service. So now let's say this is one of the requests. So you can say first the request came through ingress gateway, then it went to product page called details, product page also made a request to reviews, then reviews made a request to ratings. Now I can also see that the details service took 8 milliseconds, rating service took 1.48 milliseconds, and overall the whole request took 66 milliseconds. So you can just trace each of the requests going through each of the microservice and see where it is failing, where it is lagging, where there is latency.
Do we have the fault injection also there?
Yeah.
Can you see that? See, this one was the fault injection that we added, right? And this is running on the cluster that we have set up latest. So there is nothing backup there, right? So now all this is in place. I think the one question that comes in everybody's mind is that what about performance? What about scaling and all, right? And this is like, some people say that, okay, this is like kind of proven. Some people will say that, no, this is very new to the game. What we do, right? So I think some metrics that we have understood why it helps, some to convince ourselves that it will not be a problem. First is that the size of the Envoy proxy or any other proxy that you choose, like there are many more implementation available. Nginx has its own proxy, Linkerd and all. They are all about in the range of 10 MB size. And they are doing and working very hard to reduce every MB into it. I have heard that there is one proxy which is less than 5 MB also, right? So now your sidecar proxy which is getting injected into every pod, right? Now you have to think about it, right? If you think that it's a 200 MB, what the hell, it'll like, it'll multiply, right? So now it matters, right? And they are working very hard. So it is less than 10 MB. So that way we are covered in a way, and they are working hard to reduce this further, right? Performance also, since running in the local host itself and not a hop outside or going outside, it has some overhead involved there, which is but less than single digit milliseconds. That's what I've observed. Sometimes this performance becomes heavy when we try to do load testing, and it's not about proxy. The performance that I've observed or we have observed is all about telemetry, because it is collecting so much of data around, right? By default, it collects all the data, and we have observed that that creates little bit of overhead in terms of collecting. So header based routing works very fine because it's just the same request. You don't have to go and do anything there. But if you have to do percentage based routing and all that, it has to keep collecting that data every time, right? And it could be that there are tens of nodes running, right? All of them have to collect that data. It's just not about one node which is making a call to another service, right? So that's where it gets a little bit tricky and have a overhead of performance going high. Also, you have seen the architecture of service mesh. It is similar to the Kubernetes master, which is like control plane, and data plane, which is like your nodes, right? In Kubernetes, you know that if master goes down, even though my application will keep running, right? Same architecture, same principles. If my control plane goes down, I cannot deploy new rules. I might not be able to collect the telemetry information. However, my system can still continue to work, right? Similar principle. So you have a scalability, resiliency, all that available in the architecture. When I was reading more about it, there is one specific proxy, Cilium. They claim to be lower than the no proxy. I have to read more and understand why and all that, but yeah, there are a lot of things going on in this space. Yeah, that's all we had. Any questions, anything? And we'll make our code available on GitHub, vgirish, Agile India Istio project. Okay, you can take a photograph of this so that it's easy for you to remember if you want all the code. We'll make it available mostly today, or by tomorrow morning you will have it. Yep, we are done. And any questions? We have kept 5-10 minutes for it. We are good on time.
I have a question. How is it different from Kong or AWS
API? Kong and AWS, it's a hop, right? It's a separate outside. So when you have a incoming traffic from public, Kong is the right choice there. Now this is inter-service communication. Now you have 30 services. You will not go to Kong every time to make one service call to another, right? And that's what I was talking about. Client-side service discovery is very important. I don't want to have a central API gateway. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So Kubernetes itself comes with a lot of resiliency, right? Something goes wrong, a pod comes up, the container comes up, around into the thing. This is also being
Yeah, it's a different use case, right? That's bringing resiliency for a service. So if you look at the review service, we have three review services, version 1, version 2, version 3. In version 1, if I deploy 10 pods, if one goes down, Kubernetes is going to bring that up, not Istio. Now, Istio or Kubernetes doesn't help you to have the routing based on rules. Istio helps you to do that. Kubernetes doesn't allow you to do fault injections. Kubernetes allows you to do that. Istio allows you to do that, right? Actually, it is not even Istio. It is about the proxies who are having the actual information about what to do, right? And how to make all the calls internal.
Yeah, so
between that, how many throughputs are there, yearly data, so how much storage it will take?
It takes good amount of storage, it's telemetry data.
Yeah.
What all you want, you can reduce the telemetry data, and that's where I was talking about, right? Istio by default doesn't take too much of resources and all that stuff.
Because why we use this? Because of the regulatory concerns.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. So you have multiple options in Prometheus. It's a Prometheus feature. It's not a Istio feature, okay? Istio just sends the data, right? And the whole architecture. Prometheus is a tool where you can reduce your granularity as your day passes. Like you can say that up to 7 days, I want granular data. From 7 to 30 days, I want granular at every 15 minutes. From 30 days to 1 year, I want at 1 hour. Yes,
yeah.
it's like...
So it basically exposes slash metrics endpoints, and Prometheus is scraping those endpoints basically.
So you can use another tool also with this. So if you are comfortable with any other tool for monitoring and not Prometheus,
yeah,
it can be plugged in. Kibana is a visualization.
Yeah.
You have to use some tool to send data to Elasticsearch.
Yeah.
Yes, it can be. I think this architecture is all pluggable. You can pull out the plug components and use other components also. So all this, so Istio, the proxy supports HTTP, HTTPS, gRPC,
yeah,
and TCP protocol,
yeah,
all that is supported.
My concern is you said ANZ ports in the route.
That is for HTTP.
Yeah, for HTTP, but we want to carry this information to the next downstream services, but we fail to, because we want the communication between port A and port B would be different.
Yes.
Now, for example, you can go through the route of the ICP, you get to the route of the message broker.
Yes, so all that is possible through proxy. However, there will be some features which will be available, some features won't be available. So like this feature that we showed is HTTP header based, right? Which is specific to HTTP. So it will work in case of when you have HTTP services talking with each other. It might not work in case of TCP, but in TCP you can have another ways to inject the faults. The config changes there. Cool. Yes.
I have seen console and Kubernetes it supports. I'm not sure with Docker Swarm they have support. They might be working. Console and Kubernetes, I'm sure.
So Istio right now mostly in Kubernetes world works seamlessly. Like you have seen that we started a cluster and we had everything up and running up to distributed tracing, right? In that same new cluster which was set up. And that's the beauty of the whole Kubernetes world also. It's not just about Istio. It's about Kubernetes, Helm chart. There are many tools which are used. Cool. Good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.